Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay. Hi, everyone. It's my pleasure this afternoon to introduce Chris Burges. Even though we've been colleagues at MSR for a number of years, it wasn't until I read his bio this morning that I realized he had started in theoretical physics. since there's been no mention of supersymmetry or the Higgs boson this morning, I think it's fair to say he's moved a considerable distance since then. Chris's work in machine learning has spanned everything from handwriting recognition to audio fingerprinting, information retrieval, support vector machines, neural networks, and a number of other techniques. Today, he's going to be talking to us about one of his current interests, which is semantic modeling of language. So,
all right, thank you very much, Raul. Fantastic. So I'm wired, thanks. So I'd like to start by thanking the organizers. Can everybody hear me back? Okay, in the back? Can you hear me? Up? Okay. Good, okay. I have a quiet voice, even with amplification. So. So I'd like to thank the organizers and the program chairs, in particular Will Lewis and Anoop Sarkar. I'm honored to be given the chance to talk to you folks today. I was asked to be somewhat controversial and also technical, and I'm happy to try to oblige. But technical and controversial are hard to do at the same time, so I'm going to split the talk into two. The first part will be more speculative and perhaps thought-provoking, big picture, and the second will be some resources we've been working on that will be publicly available. And that's another reason I'm very happy to talk today is we've been working on a sort of a public service, data sets to help forward the field, we hope. So I'd like to especially thank these folks. I'm using some of their slides and information in this talk. I think most of them are here. So let's start with AI. So artificial intelligence, the quest is as old as the hills. It's as old as computer science. And unfortunately, it has a long history of high expectations not being met. So people approach this with trepidation. And when I tell people, sort of tongue-in-cheek, perhaps a little, but not completely, that I want to work on strong AI, I expect the kind of response like this, and have got it. But what was unexpected and interesting was this one. And the why wasn't so much why on earth would anybody want to solve this problem. It's a very interesting problem to solve. It's more amidst all this wonderful progress from deep learning and everything else, why attack such a hard problem? Why not just, you know, do something equally impactful, perhaps, and simpler? So this talk, I hope, contains my answer. If it doesn't, let me know at the end. So let's take a look back at artificial intelligence and ask how far we've come. So to paraphrase George Santayana, those who ignore history are doomed to repeat it. So it's good to look at the history here. There is actually a page in Wikipedia devoted to AI winters. And this is from that page. This list is a list of events that sparked an AI winter. The name winter denotes a cycle, so it looks something like this. It's interesting to me that a system that makes all the world's information available to billions of people was not on the AI radar back then. Namely, web search. I mean, it doesn't do all of this, but it's come a long way. So let's just look at the first three of these winters. The failure of machine translation. So MSR Translator has now over 100,000 companies using its services, and it's widely used internally as well. And to give you a feel for the growth, this is a graph from daily requests for translations from April 2009 to August 2013. The numbers are proprietary, so I can't show you the y-axis, but you can get an idea of the growth, 400 times since the beginning. The gaps are due to gaps in data collection, and the outlier spikes are often due to internal experimentation, or sometimes spammers. Rick Rashid gave a demo in Beijing you might have seen. It's there in case you didn't, in which his speech is recognized, translated, and regenerated in Mandarin using a model of his own voice. So we've made some serious progress on MT, but it's still far from perfect. We've got a long way to go, I think everyone would agree. The abandonment of connectionism was the second AI winter. Let's look at that. So ImageNet is an equivalent of WordNet, image equivalent of WordNet. Images are placed in an ontology like synsets, and there are several ImageNet tasks. This one is classification. So top five correct means that the correct class is in the top five choices here. This is a hard task, 1,000 classes, excuse me. And deep convolutional nets are doing pretty well. On the left, the true label is in pink. And the scores the system gives are shown by this histogram. So it gets things wrong, but understandably, this looks like, more like a, actually let me do this. More like a Dalmatian than a cherry, perhaps, right here. And it's hard to tell the difference between agaric and mushrooms. but anyway, we're doing well using old tricks. Most of the technology is quite old. But faster parallelized hardware and more data have been really crucial here. The second task is even harder. 22,000 categories in ImageNet, 7 million test images. It's much harder. The numbers here are accuracies, not error rates. So it's inverted from the previous slide. And an informal test by Trishul Chilimbi showed that humans probably get around 20% correct on this, on the top choice on this data set. So for example, and I should mention that Trishul has some groundbreaking results. I can't tell you the actual numbers because it hasn't been published, but on this data set, beating these numbers significantly. So these four images were taken from the training set. Can anybody tell which is the parliamentarian and which is the Pembroke Welsh Corgi? You don't get extra points for saying these guys are not corgis. So it turns out this guy's the parliamentarian and that guy's the Pembroke Welsh Corgi. So this is tough, a tough problem. Oops. So the third AI winter was the frustration of speech understanding research. NIST has been doing evaluations on speech since 1988, and this graph shows those evaluations from that time until 2011. The y-axis is word error rate, and in the early years, the domains were narrow, such as air travel planning, and performance was on a par with the human capability. But open domain problems are much harder, things like meeting transcription, television news, captioning. The switchboard is a benchmark, and in the late 90s, there was good progress. But for the past decade, it plateaued. And then from 2010 to 2012, whoops, lost my pointer. MSR made significant improvements using deep convolutional neural networks. Again, fairly old technology with some new tricks. So what changed here? I think that there's three things that have changed, and there's two really big things that have changed. The first is compute power. From 1971 to 2011, transistor count, the density increased by over a factor of 1,000. We also have huge clusters. So Amazon's Elastic Compute Cloud is estimated to have over 500,000 servers. And the web, we have huge data sets. So you can think of text on the web as weakly labeled data. And it's true that algorithms have progressed a lot, but I wouldn't say with orders of magnitude improvements in accuracy. I mean, we've gone from sigmoid transfer functions in units to rectilinear transfer functions. And there are other lots of cool tricks, but they're not. I just don't think you can point at them and say that they're responsible. These ideas are pretty old. So should we just continue down this path and forget strong AI for now? And for many, there's a perfectly reasonable answer is yes. It's perfectly fine. So let's take a look at AI, where we'd like to be, where we're at, and where is machine learning at, and can it provide what we think we need? So this is my blue sky slide. You may say there are several. But here are problems we'd like to solve automatically. I'll just let you read them. These are incredibly hard, right? But it's tasks like this that makes me excited about this field. And it's what got me into it. And I hope the same is true for some of you. So that's where we'd like to be in the end, right? But it's very far away. It may seem far-fetched. So how far are we? Well, there are certainly challenges in NLP. I invented this sentence here. I house table but them eaten never turnip boat, which I don't think is grammatical. But certainly for the technologies that users use to check grammars, you know, they're not very helpful in this situation. So it's largely unsolved. Paraphrase detection is also largely unsolved. This is an example of paraphrase succeeding using Chris Brockett's system that takes a sentence, translates it into many languages, translates it back into English. One of these sentences was written by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, and the other was generated automatically. Anyone want to take a guess which is which?
One is automatic.
One is automatic.
The first is automatic.
That's right. That's right. I think probably today you get better marks from an English teacher with the first sentence because it's shorter and contains the same information. The first is automatic. But paraphrases are largely unsolved problem. This is, you know, just one example that work, but there are many that don't. And I think there's a fundamental reason, which is that we need world models to inform our meaning representations, but we need a meaning representation to populate our world models. So there's this cycle we need to break into, and people are doing it. As you know, there's exciting progress. For example, this little piece of text is from data I'll be talking about in a minute. And to solve it, you know, there's technology right now that we might be able to adapt to do this by Luke and others. And it's progressing rapidly. So there's certainly interesting progress and fascinating stuff, as attested by this conference. And another example, this is a slide from Hoifeng Poon's work. So sequencing technology provides rapidly growing genomics databases, and it needs systems biology approach to interpret this data for discovering disease genes and drug targets. And the bottleneck is genetic knowledge, especially pathways, which are very complex, incredibly complex things to model. But they're in the text, they're in these papers. So we'd like to automatically extract this. And this is an example of a pass we'd like to achieve given this input from some paper. So again, work is ongoing and it's very exciting. So how about new kinds of machine learning? Is the machine learning that we have today pretty much, you know, enough? Machine learning is largely a statistical modeling discipline currently. It's used to learn over structured data with structured outputs. But I do think it's missing a few key ingredients. This is a typical bread and butter machine learning task. This is the first 800 threes in the MNIST, another NIST test, statistical learning benchmark set, that actually I had a hand in helping create this set for the machine learning community. And it's just a classification task. It's learning by example, which is essentially what the speech and image net results used that I just showed you. So this is the typical thing that people do. Another example, this is unsupervised learning. I don't know if you've seen this result, but this was actually Quoc Viet Le was an intern here, not when he did this work. They used a deep autoencoder to train images gathered from YouTube, and then they took one of the units in the middle of the autoencoder and said, which inputs light up this unit the most? And they regenerated this picture of a cat. So they generated a cat neuron automatically, which is kind of amazing. You know, there's this grandmother neuron idea of how the brain works. But text just seems way, way harder. It's more recursive, fine structure. It's not typically addressed by statistical learning models. It's hard to see how statistics would solve this. The ball fell through the table because it was made of paper. The ball fell through the table because it was made of lead. So in those two cases, it refers to something different. And you have to know that the table, if it was made of paper, could have a ball fall through it. But if it's made of lead, it probably couldn't to solve it. These are called Winograd schema sentences. I'll come back to this later. So progress has certainly been made in machine learning on language. Here's one intriguing example. This is called the skipgram model. There's certain semantic properties encoded by vectors. So you learn the vector that predicts the two previous and the two following words automatically on a ton of unlabeled data, 30 billion words. And you get vectors. And it turns out that if you take the vector for Madrid and subtract the Spainness from it and add the Franceness to it and ask what's the closest vector to this one in the space I have, you get Paris. So Paris is Madrid with Spainness removed and Franceness added, which is amazing, right? I mean, good Lord. And then they extended it to phrases, what they call an analogical test samples, and they get pretty good accuracy. So an example being New York is to New York Times as San Jose is to San Jose Mercury News. That's not easy to do. Seems like a step in the right direction. Now, you've got to be careful, though, thinking that we need to model meaning when we don't necessarily have to. Statistics either is or are powerful, depending on whether that's plural or singular. Is marble cake a food or a cake of marble? You can probably solve that just by searching for verb phrase marble cake and verb phrase noun phrase and count when noun phrase is a known food automatically. More interesting example is This one, John needs his friend, John needs his support, to whom does his refer? So there's a paper by Burges, Maryam, and Lin. You just look at a ton of unlabeled data, look for these patterns where this pronoun occurs and this word, and see what fraction of the time the gender agrees, the number agrees. And it gives you evidence that noun phrase needs pronoun support. The referent is likely not the noun phrase. So there's certainly a lot we can do with pure statistics. Surprising things we can do, really. This looks like a very tough anapher resolution problem. But it seems to me that such tricks won't be enough, probably. Here's more examples like the ball filter at the table. It's called the Winograd schema. And the first sentence was proposed by Terry Winograd in 1972. There are 141 examples of these things on this website. And it's hard to see how statistics alone would answer these. You know, Jane knocked on Susan's door, but she did not get an answer. So is that Jane or Susan that she refers to? And beyond that, these are very specific problems. They're pronominal anapher resolution problems. But there's lots of other problems, of course, where you need world knowledge to know the answer. So I don't think statistics alone, or typical machine learning approaches, will solve this. So I claim we need a lot more for machine learning. I'm only going to talk about one of these things now, but it would be great to have interpretable systems, systems that you can say, if this makes an error, I understand why it made an error. A giant six-layer neural network, it's very hard to say why it made this particular error. There's a decision surface in some space. Scalability, we'd like our systems to work in different domains and on arbitrary large data sets. We'd like them to be modular and composable for debugging purposes. People are thinking about this, but it's not front and center. And I think it will need to be for us to really make progress. So let's look at correctability. What I mean by correctability. So what I mean, there are two things very closely related, I mean. One is stability. So decision surfaces are not stable on adding new training data. So here we've got this decision surface, the green from the red. I add a green point right here. And the red point is now misclassified. Now it's misclassified, now that I've retrained. This is in stark contrast to human learning, which is very compartmentalized. So this would be like when a child learns to ride a bicycle, he forgets how to brush his teeth, right? And it just isn't how we learn. We're robust, we can learn something new without forgetting something we already knew. So we don't probably learn by moving giant decision surfaces around in some high-dimensional space. We want to be able to correct errors without introducing new errors. Another way of looking at the same problem is separability, and that is the separation of problem to subproblem. So now we have this same problem, and we want to solve the misclassified green point by adding training data. But that's like, the child makes a mistake. We don't lock him in a library for a week and ask him to update his parameters. Right? There's very few bits are transferred from the student to teacher. If you measure what they say very little. So there must be some rich shared world model that each actually has a model of in order to have this communication occur. And we're just miles away from this kind of modeling, I think, today. And machine learning, we need to think about this, I think. All right. So the nature of meaning is slippery. Actually, Will, I'm going to ask you to give me a 10-minute because my clock is completely off. Give me 10 minutes in the morning. And so I'm not going to try and define meaning because that's just a black hole. It's been discussed since Aristotle's times. It's much safer to use operational tests. And so what do we have for operational tests of meaning? There's Turing's test. But it encourages the wrong thing, namely to fool humans, as Levesque pointed out. And participants must necessarily lie. If you ask the computer about his mother or the person about what operating system he runs, he has to lie to fool you that he's, the other. And actually, we wouldn't mind knowing we're talking to a computer if it's much smarter than anybody we could possibly be talking to, right? It would be a good thing. So how about the Winograd schema? It's beautiful data, but it's expensive and hard to create this. It's quite creative generating this data. This is the original sentence Terry Winograd proposed. But it only tests pronominal and anapher resolution, too. So, question answering is huge, and I think it's a useful thing to view comprehension as simply question answering in the following sense. If any question you could ask can be answered by the system, then the system answers, comprehends the text. And this we can measure. The one thing I don't like about this definition is that it has humans in the loop. It's very hard to come up with definitions that involve meaning that don't have humans, because then you're defining meaning. So we have humans in the loop, just like Turing did. All right, so I'm going on to a good clip. So I'm going to go to part two. That was the speculative. If anybody has questions, by the way, you can jump in during the talk if you like, or hold them to the end. It's up to you. So now, we generated two data sets because there was a need for these data sets to help, we think, researchers progress in semantic modeling. And in fact, progress is often tied to the availability of good benchmark test sets. Everybody, I think, would agree. So what are the properties we require of these kinds of data sets? We like them to be public domain, copyright free. Anybody can do anything they like with this data. There has to be a very simple, clear, unambiguous measure of success. Data collection is scalable. We'd like a big gap, so between humans and machines, so, you know, it's more fun. A good baseline. Open domain yet limited scope. The problem with limited domain is you can solve the ATIS data set very, very nicely, but then you just solve the ATIS data set. We want something that's more generalizable. And ideally, we'd like a hardness knob. When people get better at it, we'd like to make the system problem harder without a huge new collection of data. And we think we've done this. So the first data set is called the Holmes data, and it's joint work with Jeff Zweig here at MSR. So this was an SAT-style sentence completion test. Take this off. And the task is to select the correct word from five candidates. We took the target sentences from five Sherlock Holmes novels from Project Gutenberg, and the training set we used for the n-gram models was also taken from Project Gutenberg. We started with 540 documents. We whittled down to 522 to make sure that everything was copyright-free. So then we used n-gram models to build decoys. And these are the novels we drew the sentences from for the test data. There's a huge variation in style and vocabulary across the 522 novels, which is why we settled on Sherlock Holmes. So it's limited scope in that sense. It's just one writer, but he can write about anything. So to generate the decoys, we select the sentence at random. We select a focus word with low frequency. We compute the trigram probability. We save the 150 highest of these for the low frequency words. If the original word wins, we reject that because it's too easy. Unfortunately, this introduces a bias in the opposite direction. And then we score by the n-gram looking forward. And then we retain the top 30. And the human judges, which was actually my family and Jeff's family, picked the best decoys, syntactically correct, but semantically unlikely. And by syntactically correct, we just mean agree on number, gender, tense, and that kind of thing. So humans had to do some curation here, and here were the rules. They must be grammatically correct. It should be a significantly better fit than decoys, the correct answer. Although decoys could fit, but the correct answer has to be. It's like an SAT test. No offensive sentences. These were written a century ago. Here's an example that requires some thought. They all require some thought. Was she his client using this discomfiture choice opportunity, his friend or his mistress? Well, friend and mistress are people, so it's probably client. So you have to think like that. Here's one that required world knowledge. Men have to be older than 7 years old, and so forth. Again, this is a fairly labor-intensive thing. Here are some samples. I'll just let you look at them. Draw your attention to two. So with this question, you need to know that fungi don't run, but that's actually not true. You could have a tree with fungi running up the side, right, sort of just there. In this context, it's true, so it's a great question. Here, you have to know that you don't stare rapidly. If you look at something, if you stare at something, you're doing it for an extended period of time, you would glance rapidly. So this does require knowledge, we think, that is hard to model. So here is how the various systems do. The human, Jeff's wife, was tested on 100 questions. The generating model didn't do as well as the n-grams because there's a bias against it, as I just explained. The smooth n-gram models were built from the CMU toolkit, And the positional combination was us being devil's advocate, us knowing exactly how this data was created, do our worst to build a system to solve the problem by knowing, you know, the tricks of the biases involved. And we got up to 43%. So we didn't succeed in our goal of trying to make this completely impervious to knowing how it was created. But it's still a far distant cry from human performance. And then latent semantic analysis does slightly better. And I'm happy to report that since then, there have been people publishing on this data set, getting quite good results. So Ni uses a vector-space model. He predicts 10 words, 5 before and 5 after. And Mikhailov uses the skipgram model I just described and does pretty well on this. But it's still far from 100%, which is, you know, we think a human less harassed might get 100% if they just take more time. And the data is available at this URL. So the URLs I'm giving today contain the papers, the background, the data, everything you need to play with this stuff. All right, onto the stories data. This is the second data set I just want to tell you guys about. This is joint work with Matt Richardson and Aaron Renshaw. And again, there's a website where we will be collecting results. So Holmes was a useful data set, but it's not really scalable. There was a lot of work to actually wind up with this 1,040 sentences. So we wanted something also more general, because that's a particular kind of test. We want something that tests comprehension. So we went to comprehending stories with multiple choice questions. This is an old problem. Charniak in 1972 worked on this kind of thing. The difference really with this is the scalability of the data collection. So reading comprehension seems like a good way to do this. We can, you know, it's how we test people's understanding of text. Again, I'll just let you read this. Progress is easy to measure with multiple choice questions. One of the pushbacks we got when we sort of did this was, you know, maybe first grade's too easy, guys. Come on. Is it? So this is a parent's guide to the first grade curriculum. I don't know if you can read this, but let me just read it to you. Describe, retell, ask, and answer questions about key ideas and details. Explain the differences between fact and fictional stories. That's a really hard problem to automate. Begin reading complex texts such as prose and poetry. These are not machine-solved problems at all. So we do not think that first grade is too easy. In fact, we think it's the opposite. If you saw first grade, you've probably gone a long way to solving everything. So the MC test data looks like this. Fictional stories, meaning you can't go to Wikipedia to find the answer. The answer is in the story and only in the story. Sam's birthday is tomorrow. When is Sam's birthday? Multiple choice. We limited the vocabulary to what a typical 7-year-old would know to try and limit the scope, but keep it open domain. There are no copyright issues. This was generated using Mechanical Turk. So you're free to use this data any way you like. We looked into using SAT and the rest, but we couldn't do it. And we wound up with 660 stories. And we've done this in such a way that we think we could collect 10 times as much. If there's interest in this community on this data set, we will collect more and support it. So we paid $250 a story set, because they had to write a story and 4 questions, and for each question, 4 answers, one of which is correct and 5 are incorrect. And we got a wide variety of questions. So MTurk has over 500,000 workers. They're typically more educated than the US population in general, and the majority of workers are female. Just curious statistics. This is an example story set from the first 160. And to solve this, I put the correct answer on top. That's not true in the data that's on the web. You need to know that turning 2 years old happens on a birthday, for example. And there are some extremely challenging NLP problems buried in this data, I mean, an alpha resolution in particular, where it refers to something several sentences back. So what we did was we did a little test run of 160 of these stories. We gathered 160, and then we curated them manually. And that led to ideas on how to do a second run of the data collection that was more automated, so we know how to scale. And we were also worried that people would write that the ball was blue, and the question is, what color was the ball? It's too easy, right? So we asked that they have at least 2 of the 4 questions require multiple sentences to answer. So you have to go into the text in 2 places. This is actually very confusing for the MTurkers, what we meant by this. We struggled with trying to explain what we meant by this. We did fix errors on the 160, and we found certain workers to avoid. So we touched about 2/3 of the stories. And this enabled us to improve the process to generate much more data. So now we collected 500 more stories. We automatically verified that the distractors appear in the story, otherwise it's too easy, if only the correct answer appears in the story. Unless the correct answer does not appear in the story, because it might be like, how many candies did Jim eat? And the answer's not in the story, but you should be able to get it. Creativity terms, we wanted to increase diversity, so we took 15 random nouns from the vocabulary and presented them to the users and said, use these nouns if you like, but you don't have to. We added a grammar test, which actually had a significant impact on the quality of the stories. Thank you very much. And then we added a second Turk task to grade stories and questions. So here's the grammar test. I came up with this, mostly. Half of these are grammatically incorrect. And we required that the workers get at least 80% correct to do the task. And we found that requiring 90% correct would have extended the data collection time from days to weeks. So 80% was what we went for. I won't test you on the grammar test. Okay. So here's the effect of the grammar test. We took 10 stories without randomly chosen, with and without the grammar test in place that were generated. And then we blindly graded each for quality. And you can see it made quite a difference. So the quality measures we had were, do not attempt to fix the story. It's bad, but it's rescuable. Has no minor problems, has minor problems, has no problems. And interestingly, somewhat randomly, it also reduced the number of stories about animals significantly. And the quality was just better.
Does that include humans or not?
Does not include humans. So then we had each story set evaluated by 10 Mechanical Turk workers and with the following measures. And we also had them answer the questions. And what that enabled us to do was to say, if the MTurker couldn't answer the questions themselves, then they probably shouldn't be trusted in, I mean, perhaps the story is terrible, but throw out the guys that just can't even answer the questions themselves. So we removed the guys that got less than 80% accuracy, about 4% of people. And then we just did a manual inspection. Now, this is manual, so it's less scalable, but there wasn't much time needed. One person, one day. And we actually corrected, you know, polished it up to make the stories make sense or the questions and answers make sense for this small subset of the data. Okay, so we think we can get actually a factor of 10 more data pretty easily if we need to. So this is a note on the quality of the automated data collection. The grammar test improves MC500 significantly. So here, this is without any grammar test, and this is with. The editing process improves MC500 clarity and also the number correct. And MC160 still has a better grammar. So still, we didn't get as good as manually creating the stories ourselves by doing this automated Mechanical Turk, but it's a lot better than it was. Then we wrote a simple baseline system. I won't go into details because of lack of time, but it's basically a sliding window. You take the question, the answer, build a set of words, slide it over the story, look for hits, do a TF-IDF count, the highest answer wins, which worked pretty well, and then we added that, that sort of ignores things outside of this moving window, so then we added a distance algorithm of the distance of the question, distance in the story from the question words to the answer words. This is the whole thing, it's very simple, and it returns this difference of scores. And this is how it does. It gets about 60% correct when random would be 25% correct. And the MC160 is easier, as we said. Having a grammar test and the other tests actually made the data harder. So here, single refers to questions that require only one sentence in the story to answer. Multi requires multiple sentences. And these are the two data sets. And in fact, really for us, everything is a test because only this was used to actually build the model. So all of this is test and all of this is test. And here W is the window and D is the distance algorithm. So one of the tests we did is we were worried that someone would come along, we're still worried, and solve the whole thing with some trick. So what about viewing this as a textual entailment problem? Let's use an off-the-shelf textual entailment system and that says given text T and hypothesis H, does T entail H? So we can turn the questions and answers into statements like this. There's software Sylvia Chukazan had for a different project, question answering on the web, that we could use to do this. And then we select the answer with the highest likelihood of entailment, and we used an off-the-shelf system, which actually turned out not to do as well as the baseline by itself. although combined with the baseline did slightly better. That this may not be fair to the system BUT. There are reasons it may have failed. It may not be tuned for this task. Question to statement conversion is not perfect, and so forth. But it was an interesting test that we can get close, but the baseline is pretty solid here. At least the first thing we tried, first sophisticated thing we tried, was not as good as the baseline. So MT is a good resource, and I hope you'll use it. We will maintain this on the web. The data itself, but also people's results on it. So if you want to compare with somebody else's system, you're going to be able to get scores per question per answer to see how your system compares with theirs. And you can do paired t-tests and things like that on the data. So we want to keep pretty much everything that people might want to use for that reason. OK, I still have 5 minutes, so I'm quickly going to show you a bit more work we did. Right? I will stop on time. This is work I did with Aaron and Andre. Labeling this data set. We only labeled MC160, but we've labeled it pretty exhaustively. And these labels will also be made available on the web for, you, for anybody to use, of course. Labels are useful for machine learning, but they're also useful to isolate parts of the system you want to work on and have everything else work perfectly to just say how that part's doing. And similarly, it helps provide, for the same reasons, a testbed for experimenting with feedback. So if the CoRef module and the downstream module are switched on, everything else is just using labels, we can see how the downstream module feeds back and how that works and all the rest. These are the labels we have now. We seeded the sets with Splat, which is MSR's toolkit, and another toolkit we have. We've even done CoRef chains. And now I did a lot of this labeling. I learned a lot about labeling this stuff. It was interesting to me. We also have been playing with the Wall Street Journal data. So in the Wall Street Journal data, chief executive officer, even labeling nouns is tough. The word, executive is labeled as a noun about half the time and an adjective about half the time in WSJ. He went downstairs. Downstairs is an adverb, according to OED. The outside can be a noun, adverb, preposition, or adjective. And CoRef gets even more complicated. But we're going to try not to worry about that, since if we made a perfect CoRef system, we'd be spending all the time just doing the labeling. But here are some of the labeling issues. You had a whole bunch of mentions of Sam and then Peter and then the word they. Well, that's a CoRef chain with Peter and Sam, but which Peter and Sam? Which tokens? So we just put the two previous mentions in the chain. And then you can have something like Sarah and Tim, which is referred to by they, but then Sarah by she and Tim by he. So the mention and submentions, right? Same with John's shirt. And then this is a really tough one. I don't know if anybody can really get this. So Bob was Bob the Clown during the day, and night he became Bob the Axe Murderer. Bob the Clown was a nice guy. Bob didn't know which Bob he preferred. Where do we put that Bob? Which, yeah, tough. And here's my favorite. This is just because I've been looking at number for CoRef. My family is large, and tonight they are all coming to dinner. The same token is singular here and plural here. So you have to deal with that kind of stuff. So I'm going to wrap up because I'm fairly... let's just do 2 minutes. I can do this in 2 minutes. OK. So then we also labeled animacy. Again, animacy is tricky. Are dead opera singers animate? Caruso is considered one of the world's best opera singers. He, you know, in that sentence, it'd be useful to treat him as animate even though he's not alive, right? So we treated animate as at one time animate. Collectives can be animate. The team went out for lunch. Cats like naps. People like sunshine. And some things are just not clear. One boy was named James. Well, James refers to a name, which is not animate, but it also refers to James himself, who is. So that's tricky. And then we did a little bit of testing on the data I just showed you. How ambiguous are the nouns? It's 8,000 words. How hard could it be? Well, the number of noun senses in WordNet of these nouns is about 4 for each noun on average. And the word senses are here. And these don't include these kinds of ambiguities, part of speech ambiguities. So there's definitely a problem. You know, this is a tough problem. Similarly, for verb meanings, how many verb meanings are there? So we identified the verbs using the splat part of speech tagger. And then we went to simple wiktionary and asked for how many simple wiktionary and asked for how many verbs. This is a lot more if you use the full wiktionary. So mostly they had one, but there's things that have 35. So blow up, explode, get bigger, whistle blows, he blew the whistle. These are all different meanings of blow. We couldn't use full dictionary because it just goes over the board. Alligator is a verb, ash is a verb in full dictionary, and it's just going too far for us. All right, thank you very much. Zero. I'm surprised I got through that, actually.
Do we have some time for questions?
Or just points? Or
a lot of times.
You said humans don't forget things when they learn new things. My kids did overgeneralization for a while, learning to speak, right? They would say went and then later goed for a little while before they went back to went.
Yes. Fair point. But I think in general, when you take an adult human and they learn something new, it's hard to find examples like this. It's true maybe for kids, but people are learning every day all the time while they live, right? And we don't see this phenomenon very much. Certainly it's true in children to some extent. That's a good point, yeah. So maybe, I don't know what that says about the brain. Maybe something interesting, yeah.
I was just wondering about the fictional content in the stories, whether that's kind of distracting from the task of building, you know, accurate models of the real world when you have talking animals and...
Yes, that's a good point. The ball was blue and the ball was happy and all that kind of... And we get stories like this. That's true. It makes it harder, right? Because you can't say because the ball in the real world occurs as inanimate, it's inanimate here. We really wanted this set to be self-contained in the sense you couldn't go to Wikipedia and get the answer, or the web and get the answer. So fiction kind of solves that problem, but it does raise other problems. And in fact, we would like to add nonfiction. So we don't want to stop here. We just wanted to start with something to work with. But we felt that the benefits outweighed the there are problems. Yeah, it makes it a harder problem for sure.
So at the beginning of your talk, you were kind of asking the question, do we have all the bag of tricks we're going to need from machine learning now? And so my question for your data set is it the kind of problem that we haven't defined what we need to know from the problem to, or about the problem to answer these, so we don't have machine learning techniques for an unknown problem?
So that first part of the talk is just opinion, so I have no, you know, I don't know the answer to this question. It's a subtle question. So you're saying we don't even know if what we have is sufficient or not. But we can look at limitations of what we have, and there are some pretty strong limitations of current approaches. So I think it's, like, for example, interpretability. You know, if I'm talking to you and I clearly misunderstand something you say, you can detect that and correct it with just a few bits of information. So you have some model, some interpretation of my error and of what I understand. I mean, teachers do this all the time. But that kind of learning we tend not to have in machine learning models, right? So it may be that we don't need any of this stuff. I'm told this, right? There are skeptics who say you will not need any of this stuff, just use deep learning and lots of data and, you know, see where it goes. And that's actually a perfectly valid approach, I think. But I think it's worth considering this question because it might be true, right? So it might be that coming up with a model which is interrogable, you can ask it why it believes what it believes and understand it. It sounds rule-based, but and do this in a scalable way, which rule-based systems tend not to be. You know, if we can solve these problems, I think interpretability is very powerful if you understand why the system is making the mistake it makes and you can correct only that mistake, then that's progress, right? Whereas if I have to just retrain, I don't know what else is going to break. So I don't know if that answers your question. I sort of rambled on a bit. Does that help?
Well, so I guess my particular question is, in this new data that you've defined, in some sense, we don't know what it's going to take to solve that problem.
So we have done an informal test of the new data of roughly how many questions need a world knowledge, like the kind of example I was giving, the ball fell through the table because it was made of paper, that kind of thing. I mean, we get about 30%. So we need something with world knowledge for sure to really know that we're solving this. So that's not been done yet, right? We don't have a reliable, scalable world model.
So one way in which this has a flavor of a task that might be gamed slightly is that as far as I understand it, in every case you actually do have an answer available
true.
In the story. Have you thought about augmenting it with distractors where a human would be able to recognize fairly straightforwardly that the answer is not present?
Great question. And in fact, that's one of the ways we plan on making the data set harder if it turns out to be too easy. We just randomly remove some of the correct answers and put in imposters and all four, and you don't know which is which. So we are thinking about how to make this data harder as we collect it. There's another way which is kind of interesting, and that is take this baseline, run it in real time as the mechanical Turkers do their thing. If it's too easy, if the baseline gets it, then you know, have them do another one. Then it can make it really tough because you know it beats the base and the baseline can't do it. So I think there are ways to make the data arbitrarily hard. Certainly making, the step you suggest is a kind of intermediate step, but then there's just write down the answer, right? And that's even harder. So, but that's hard to measure too, because then you've got paraphrase to solve.
So related to that, since 70% of the stories were initially about animals, it shows that people aren't very creative in coming up with the stories. So how well do you think you could do without reading the story?
It's interesting you should ask that question. So we did a crazy experiment. Let me finish with this crazy experiment. We were intrigued by these vector results, right? People are getting amazing results with vectors. So we threw away the story. We threw away the question. This is just the first crazy baseline you do. We took the answers, and we assigned a random vector to each word. And what did we do? We found that we get 31% correct, so not the 25% you'd expect, by comparing. What was it? I don't remember. Just by looking at the answers themselves. So the answers themselves are biased, right? They tend to be longer, the correct answers. They tend to be more about baseball than cricket, you know, because baseball's more popular. So there are definite biases you can pick up automatically just by training on just the answers. And you have to be careful about that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Question here. So it seems like there might be a slippery slope about being disjunctions in the sentence or sentences requiring math computations. So how did you curate to make sure that there wasn't something that said, you know, John had 5 balls and Susie took 2, so how many balls were left?
There are rather few of those. We did look at all the stories, and the 160 we looked at very carefully, actually. But it's funny you should mention that, because there's one story that was completely insane. It was about people going to the fair, and there's a jar full of jelly beans, and you have to guess how many there were. And somebody took 10, another person took 5. But he never said how many were in the jar to start with. And the question was, how many were left? Right? So it's impossible. It's an impossible question. So we just had to ditch the story, really, because, I mean, it was really... So there are biases we should worry about. But I think the fact that there are so many people... Yeah, animals are in the stories, but they're actually surprisingly varied. If you look at the main topic wasn't animals in these stories. It was all over the map. It was sort of, there are birthdays and parties and parks and pets quite a bit, but there's a surprising variety of topics there. Does that help answer your question?
Yeah, and also about disjunctions, you could have set operations across the whole story, which might be difficult to compute and might need to invoke a different sort of module that actually does the set computation.
I think that's true. In fact, we're also attacking this data ourselves. I haven't talked about that at all. But we would like to attack it from that point of view of taking these little tiny things like find the sets in the story, find the events in the story, find the entities, find the animate entities, do the co-ref and see how far we get with just sort of breaking off little pieces. So that's what we're attacking right now. We're building a platform to do this with help from the NLP team.
Okay, we have time for one more, just so we have time to transition. This guy has the mic.
So in the beginning, you talked about the Turing test and how maybe the computer should know that it's a computer instead of trying to...
Right.
And so maybe the world knowledge of computers is then in the computer domain. And so instead of using stories that talk about animals and gravity and paper, what if the stories were about things in computers, like bits and bytes and processes and operating
systems?
How
many files do you have in this directory? You know, stuff like that. Yeah.
I mean, would that change? I mean, so that's an interesting, you know, how does that really connect, you know, where you're
talking? So you're saying, that's an interesting question. So still natural language, so still an interesting hard task, but in a very limited domain about what the computer knows about itself. You know, what is your memory?
Well, and also following instructions, right? My personal project is about README files and following the instructions that are in README files.
Having the computer follow instructions?
Yes.
Yeah, well, that's a wonderful thing to work on. And I think it's pretty hard, too. yes, that's an interesting point. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, let's start. We have two talks in this session. Each one will be 15 minutes followed by 5 minutes question. And the first talk, the title is here, and it's going to be presented by Enamul.
Thanks a lot. So I'm going to present a visual text analytic system for exploring block conversation. This work has been done in our NLP group at UBC with my supervisor, Giuseppe Carenini. And this work has been accepted in the EuroVis conference to be held this year at UK. So as we all know that in the last few years, there has been this tremendous growth of online conversations in social media. People talk to each other in different domains such as blogs, forums, and Twitters to express their thoughts and feelings. And so if you look at some statistics of a particular domain such as blogs, we could see some very fascinating figures. So as you could see, there is more than 100 million of blogs already there in the internet, and this figure is keep rising exponentially. So now that we have so many blog conversations and other threaded conversations in the internet, we might start wondering whether the current interfaces are sufficient enough to support the user task and requirements. So let's have a look at an example of a blog conversation from Delicos, which is a political blog site. And this particular blog conversation started with talking about Obamacare health policy, and then it's also started talking about some other related topics. And then other people started to make comments about this particular article, and very quickly it turns into a very complex, long thread of conversation. So imagine a new user coming to read this conversation, having seen all this comments in a large thread, make it almost next to impossible to go over each of the comment and trying to understand and get insight from what this conversation is all about and what are the different opinions and viewpoints are being expressed within the conversation. So that leads to the information overload problem. And as a result, what happens is that the reader or the participant of the conversation, they start to skip the comments. They often generate shorter response. And eventually, they leave the discussion prematurely without fulfilling their information needs. So the question is, how can we address this problem better so that, we can support the user task in a more effective way? So there has been some approach in the information visualization community. And what they're trying to do is that they're trying to visualize some of the metadata of the conversation. Especially, these are the earlier works where they're trying to visualize the thread structure. The idea is that by visualizing this thread structure, one could possibly navigate through the conversation in some better way. But the question is, does it really tell anything about the actual content of the conversation? That's not the case. So by seeing this visualization, a reader can hardly ever understand what's the actual content of the conversation is all about. And so, very recently, they moved on to some simple NLP using in their visualization research. So for example, this work in early 2006 tries to use some very simple TF-IDF-based statistics using over the timeline, trying to visualize the topical overflow or the terms overflow over time. And similarly, recently, Tiara system from IBM, they're also trying to visualize like LDA-based topic model over time, trying to show the topical evolution so that the user can kind of get some insight about how the conversations evolve over time. But then still, the underlying NLP methods are either too simple so that they're more error-prone, or they're not designed specifically for the conversation, so that's make it difficult to get insight. On the other hand, NLP approaches are trying to figure out different content information, extracting content information from the conversation. So things like topic model is trying to assign a topic label into the different topical clusters of the conversation. Sentiment analysis is trying to mine the sentiment information for different sentences in the conversation. Similarly, we have summarization that are trying to pick the most important sentences or generating abstract sentences. We could have some other relations being extracted, such as speaks at or rhetoric relations. But the question is, sometimes this output of the NLP can be too complex to be consumed by the user, or the question is whether the user is really wanting to see all those different complex output of the system. Do they really want to see the speech acts, or do they really want to see the rhetoric relations? So that's why we argue that we need to combine both NLP methods and InfoVis together in a synergic way so that both techniques can complement each other. So the goal of this work is to combine NLP and InfoVis in a synergistic way. And in particular, to make this happen, we ask the following questions. For a specific domain of conversation, such as blogs, what are the NLP methods that we should apply? Then what metadata of the conversations are actually useful to the user for performing that task? And how this information should be eventually visualized so that this can actually helpful to the user. To answer all these questions, we apply a human-centered approach for design. And this was proposed by Tamara Manzner for InfoVis application. It's kind of commonly adopted in InfoVis, but there has not been much work in the area of visual text analytics where the idea is to combine both NLP and InfoVis together. So this is kind of one of the earlier, so our work is kind of one of the earlier work that is trying to use this nested model to combine NLP and InfoVis together. So in particular, this nested model, using this nested model, what we are trying to do is that we are trying to use a systematic approach to go through a set of steps to eventually design a visual text analytic system. So first, taking a domain of conversations such as blogs, we characterize what are the tasks that the user perform. And then based on that, we pick the data and tasks that are useful to the user. And then we mine those data from the conversation by using NLP methods. And finally, we develop the interactive visualization system for the conversation. So in the next few minutes, I'll go over each of these steps. So first, to characterize the domain of blogs, we rely on the literature on different areas such as computer-mediated communication, social media, human-computer interaction, and information retrieval. The question that we ask when we review this literature is trying to understand why and how people actually read blogs. And by asking this question, we get results from the literature. For instance, people read blogs because of they want to seek more information. They want to check some fact with traditional media, or they might want to keep track of arguments and evidences, and maybe they just want to get fun out of it. Similarly, we also analyze how they want to read blogs, and then using all this information, we decide what tasks are usually performed by the blog readers and what kind of data that we should use to support those tasks. And so in the next step, we came up with a set of tasks based on the domain analysis that we have done in the previous step. So these are some of the tasks that typically a user might want to perform when they read blogs. For example, they might want to ask questions about what this conversation is about, which topic is generating more discussion, how controversial was the conversation overall, was there any lot of differences in opinion. And so once we have this list of questions and each question is representing a task, the next step is we try to identify what data variables are actually involved in this task. So to do so, we identify a set of data variables that are actually involved within this task. Some of them could come from the NLP methods. For instance, topic modeling and opinion mining could help in some of those tasks. While also we could use some other metadata of the conversation, such as author, thread, and comment. So once we identify those data variables, the next step is to mine the data from the conversation using the NLP method. So specifically, we use topic modeling and sentiment analysis. So in case of topic modeling, we use a method that has been developed specifically for dealing with conversational data. So in this case, to take advantage of the conversational structure, we take the information of reply relationships between comments and then turns into a graph called fragment quotation graph. So where we are representing is node as a fragment, and the edge is representing the replying relationships between fragment. The intuition behind representing this fragmentation graph is that if one comment or a fragment is replying to another fragment, then there is a high probability that the fragment that is commenting to its parent comment or fragment talking about the same topic. So basically, from this, we can actually inform the topic modeling process. So later on, using this fragment quotation graph, we first do the topic segmentation, where we basically we cluster the whole conversation into different topical cluster. So in this step, first we apply lexical cohesion-based segmentation on each of the path of the conversation. So we basically treat each path of the conversation as a separate conversation. And then we run this lexical cohesion-based segmentation, which is commonly used in other like meeting and other corpora to segment, to do the topical segment. And then once we have those segmentation decision, we need to consolidate it for the whole conversation. And for that purpose, we use a graph-based technique. So first we represent the segmentation decisions into a graph. So we represent the graph where each node is representing a sentence and each edge is representing how many times two sentences actually co-occur in the same segment while running this lexical cohesion. So then this normalized cut clustering technique clusters into a set of topical clusters. And then the next step is to just to assign representative key phrases for each topical cluster. So we apply a syntactic filter that only picks nouns and adjectives for each topical cluster. And then we use a co-rank method that again take advantage of the conversational structure by providing more boosting to those keywords that are coming from the leading sentence from each topic. So the initial sentences from each topic are more important than the rest of the sentence. That's kind of the intuition behind the ranking method. So at the end of this step, we have a set of topical clusters. Each topical cluster has been assigned with a set of key phrases. And then we also did this sentiment analysis using the SoCal system. So it's a lexicon-based approach where we use this program to find the sentiment and orientation and polarity for each sentence. And then for each comment of the conversation, we compute the polarity distribution, that is how many sentences are actually falling in any of this polarity interval. So once we have done that, we design the visualization. And in this process, we actually first start with a paper prototyping. So we do a lot of prototyping trying to impose some of the principles that we want to promote in the interface. For instance, we want to promote multifaceted exploration based on different facets such as topic, opinions, and authors. And then we also want to use some lightweight interactive features that can help the user to promote this exploration activity. So this is the final interface that we came up with. I'm going to show a demo right now. So in this interface, in the middle, we have the thread overview that's kind of showing the parent-child relationships between comments, and it's also showing the sentiment analysis result. Circularly around this thread overview, we have topics and authors that are showing the exploration for using facets. So now I'm going to show a quick demo of this interface. So this is how the interface looked like. So the user can quickly see what is the structure of the thread, and they can quickly look at the topics and kind of understand the evolution of topic over the conversation. And if they're interested about a particular topic, they can highlight, they can hover the mouse over that, and that highlights the corresponding comments as well as the authors that are related to a particular topic. And then if they're interested about a particular topic, they can click on it, and that kind of put some bars on each of these comments. So then the next step would be they can go over each comment, and as a result, the system scrolls down to the actual comment in the right side, and they can then quickly browse through each comment from the overview interface. Similarly, they can also go through the detail view, and that kind of also mirror the corresponding operations in the overview. So as you can see, as the user scrolls down, that also highlights the corresponding comment in the overview. that's kind of providing the idea where they're currently right now and what topic they're currently in. So that's kind of how the interface looks like. So I'm going to wrap up with, I guess it's, so we've recently did an informal evolution, and using the informal evolution, we are trying to understand how the people are actually using this interface and how that is they are getting helped by this interface. In the future, we are trying to incorporate the interactive feedback loop from user so that they can perform their some interactive feedback to the actual topic model. So they can say that this topic is actually more broader, so I want to make this topic to be more splitted versus this topic. These topics are too specific, so I want to merge them together. So our idea is to make more control back to the user so that they can have more more control over the topic model and the text analysis itself. Okay, so that's all.
Sorry, when you did the human evaluation, perhaps if you could go back one slide. Oh, thanks. So what were you asking the bloggers to evaluate? Did they have a particular task that they needed to accomplish using your interface?
The idea was that instead of giving some very specific tasks, which might be more synthetic because these tasks are more exploratory in nature and there is no specific aim the user have before they read the blogs, and so we just asked them to read the blog according to their own needs by reading the comments that they like. And then after reading the conversation, they would write a summary. And then from there on, we also collect the interaction log data that they perform, what kind of interface actions that they make. And then based on that, we analyze the output of the evolution.
Did the bloggers use different ways of getting through this information, or did you see all of them using kind of going from the topics?
Yeah, so we clearly identified two different strategies for exploration. So some of the bloggers, they would use the visual overview. More specifically, they would click on topics, mm-hmm. and then they would either go to this thread overview and then click on specific comments and read that particular comment. On the other hand, other group of users, they almost use this topic very less frequently, and they would mostly go over the detailed view, very quickly skimming through the comments, but then at the same time, they would have a situational awareness of what's going on in this overview. So they would kind of coordinate between these two views in a way that while they're reading in the detailed view, they would kind of understand what topic they're currently reading and what position they're currently in the thread overview. So that's kind of allowed them to read some of the comments that are even buried down near the end of the conversation. Mm-hmm. So in this way, what we have identified compared to the traditional system, usually people start reading some of the top few comments and then they totally get lost at some point and quit at some point. Whereas using this interface, they can find and read some of the interesting comments that were really buried down near the end. So I guess that's kind of making a difference in terms of where they explore the comments.
We have time for one quick question.
What is that bar underneath the user?
These bars?
Yeah.
This is just mirroring the same from here. So this is representing the sentiment information for each comment. So we define 5 different polarity intervals, and it's just showing as a stack bar. And this stack bar is the same as here. We just mirrored the corresponding stack bar.
Just for that comment?
Yeah, just for that
comment. Not whether the user is generally a negative person?
Just for that comment. So this is for each comment.
I guess we need to move on to the next talk. Well, let's thank the speaker again.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ramtin Mehdizadeh, and I am a graduate student at NatLang Lab. Today, I'm going to talk about graph propagation for paraphrasing out-of-vocabulary words in SMT. I'm extending this work for my research, which is done by my colleagues and presented in ACL 2013. One of the big challenges in statistical machine translation is out-of-vocabulary words, which are missing in the training set. And this problem becomes severe when we have a small amount of training data, or we have a test set in a different domain than the training set. Even noisy translation of OVs helps the reordering. For example, consider this Spanish sentence. If we pass this sentence to an SMT trained on Europol corpus, we will get the sentence similar to this output. We showed that there are some words here, like this word, that is not a name entity or days or number, but it's still OV. We want to use monolingual corpus for the source site to create a graph to find paraphrases to OVs for which we have translation. Let's look at our framework. First, we will use our training set to create a translation model. And by using this translation model, we will extract OVs from our test set. By using our source site graph that I will explain later, we will extract some translation for these OV words. And then we will integrate these translations to our original translation model. Each node in our graph is a phrase, and we create our graph based on the distributional hypothesis, and we will use a context vector to create our graphs nodes. And then we will use paraphrase relationship to connect these nodes in our graph. For creating such a huge graph, we need to take advantage of Hadoop MapReduce functionality. And for obtaining translation for these OVs, we will use graph propagations. And our graph propagation algorithm here is modify absorption. For each node in our graph, we consider a distributional profile, and we will create this distributional profile based on context vector throughout the whole corpus. We need an association measure to show how related you are, how much you are related to words other than you in the vocabulary. For example, consider co-occurrence frequency as an association measure. In this example, we want to show how we can create this distributional profile for a token which is shown as a red point here. We have some occurrence of this word into our monotone text. We will consider fixed size window and count the number of words in the neighborhood. By using point-wise mutual information, we can find the correlation between neighborhood words and our node word. And positive value in this formulation shows the co-occurrence more than the expected value under independence assumption. Now, for each node, we have a distributional profile in a V-dimensional space. How we can measure the similarity between two nodes? Suppose we have just two dimensions. Dimension one is word car, and dimension two is word cat. For two nodes, park and tail, we can use cosine coefficient to find the distance and to find the similarity between these two words. In our graph, we have some labeled nodes. Labels here correspond to translation from a phrase table. And also, we have some out-of-vocabulary nodes. Previous words, works used just these two types of nodes to find translation for always. In our work, for the first time, we use some other unlabeled node, which did not appear in our test set. These nodes can help as a bridge to transfer translation to OV words that are not connected directly to labeled nodes. Here's the objective function of modified absorption. The first term ensured that for seed nodes, we will have a distribution over labels as much as possible to similar to the original distribution, the initial values. And second term ensures that nodes that are highly connected, strongly connected, should have similar distribution over labels. And the second term and the third term is a regularizer. It implies prior belief into the graph, as you can see. Now we want to add the new translations into our phrase table. We consider a new feature and set it to 1 for our original translation phrases. And then we add our new translations by set it one by set sets other features to 1 and just add the probability obtained from graph propagations to this new feature. For our experiment, we select the French-English task. By using French side of Europol, we construct our graph. We consider two different parallel texts to check first that our method is working on a small amount of parallel data or not. And also, we consider this training set to see that if we can improve the result when we have a domain shift. For test and dev set, we used WMT 2005. And we showed that if we remove name entities, dates, and numbers, 3.2% of tokens is still from dev set and test set is still always in Europol. And as you can see, this value is more because we have a domain shift. For evaluations, first type of our evaluation was intrinsic evaluation. First, we don't have any gold label for OVs, so we concatenate dev set and test set to our training set and run word aligner and then extract all of aligned word on the target site as a standard goal and add it to a list. So, since our gold standard is noisy here, we use MRR as a natural choice to compare these two lists, and also recall as a measure. This graph shows the impact of size of monotext, and 1x corresponds to using 125 K sentences from Europol. And as you can see, there is a linear correlation between the logarithm of the text size and MRR and recall. We also consider different type of graphs. The bipartite one is just using labeled nodes and out-of-vocabulary nodes. Tripartite is just connecting we will support connecting out-of-vocabulary words to unlabeled nodes and then using as a bridge to labeled nodes. And full graph is just connecting all nodes together. As you can see, there is a failure when we are using the full graph. There are some reasons behind this, and we can say that a paraphrase of paraphrase of a paraphrase of an OOV does not necessarily be a good paraphrase for an OOV. So this is the reason that we think that a full graph is not working. And also, we consider two types of nodes. First, we use unigrams, and then we select bigrams. As you can see, bigrams has a better MMR. Here's a real example of our work. For this OOV, we find the gold standard approval, and this is the candidate list generated by our graph propagation method. But how much our method can affect a real SMT? For extrinsic results, we consider blue scores, and we showed that we statistically significant can improve the blue score by using this type of graph propagation. We provide a new method to use monolingual text for the source site for SMT, and also we showed that we will have an improvement when we have a small size of byte text, or we have a domain adaptations. For the future, we want to use metric learning for constructing a graph, and also using locality sensitive hashing and SMT integrations. Thanks a lot for your attention.
Thank you for the talk. I have actually two questions kind of related. The first one is your edges in your graph. Are they weighted or they are not? So when you build the graph.
They are connected or not?
No, they are. Are they weighted?
Yeah, they are weighted. Their weight is based on the how much they can be paraphrased.
Okay.
And we calculate this by using this coefficient measure. Let me show you. Excuse me. Coefficient measure between two distributional profile of them.
And the second question I have is that at some point in your slides you mentioned about the fixed window that you choose to build your similarity metric. And you said that you fix it to 3, right?
No, for the window size for finding the neighbors
yes.
is not fixed to 3.
Oh, okay.
We consider 6 in our experiment.
Oh, 6. And you tested on different sizes of windows?
Yeah. Actually, we have the result for that. Okay. This is experiments on different size of window and n-grams.
Okay. And then you choose 6 for your final result, right? The result that you show.
Here, no. In this experiment, we select 4.
Yeah.
But later we tried 6.
Okay. Thank you.
We still have time for questions.
So in that vector that you mentioned that you did cosine before, what did you put in the cells? How do you fill the cells of the vectors?
Okay.
The similarity measure.
Okay. So the similarity measure here is we used pointwise mutual information, And we use distributional profile, if I get the question. Yeah, the question was that? Or?
Yeah, so use PMI.
Yeah, PMI. We experiment different types of similarity. Oh, sorry. I should not go there. We experiment different types of association measure and similarity, and using pointwise mutual informations as association measure and cosine coefficient as a similarity has the best result.
Do you have variable length phrases? You use unigram, bigram, trigram?
We tried on unigrams and bigrams. Now we are trying to extend it to phrases with more length.
So the result here is bigram and unigram?
Right? Yeah.
And how you decide to expand during the graph construction? How you decide you keep expanding the neighbors?
In our experiments, we consider the how much is, you know, when we expand this, we will face some computational problem. So we just consider that how we can get good results in terms of not needing too much computation.
So what is the criteria you decide that you keep expanding the graph or you stop expanding?
Sorry?
What is the criteria used to expand the graph or these nodes or stop expanding so far? Because you can keep expanding the neighbors and
okay.
It will be very large graph.
We actually consider five nearest neighbor for each node.
Five.
Because more than this, it was not practical. And because it's going to be very huge and graph propagations is not very cheap.
Thank you.
Any more questions? We have only 1 minute left. Okay, if not, let's thank both speakers. Yeah.